Hello, let me talk about reinforced cement concrete water tanks, circular water tanks resting on ground by working stress method. This is lecture number 5. So let us begin. Now these are two photographs of water tanks resting on ground. This is the circular wall of the water tank, and then there will be base slab which will also be a circular, and it is directly resting on the ground. Circular water tanks are used for large capacity in the fields of water supply, sewage treatment pumping stations, chemical processing and large underground sumps. The perimeter of circular shape for a given area is the least than any other shape. That means if we take the area and we want to make rectangular, square or any other shape other than circular shape, then for the same area the perimeter will be more, whereas the perimeter in case of circular shape will always be the minimum value as compared to any other shape, and therefore this makes the circular water tanks more economical than any other shapes of water tanks. But however, for tanks of small capacity, the formwork for circular tanks is costly, and therefore rectangular tanks are normally used when the tank capacity is small. There are two types of constructions which are adopted on the site. Number one, the side wall is free to expand or contract because the joint provided between the floor and the side wall is flexible, that is sliding joint. That means there is no rigidity or there is no fixity between the circular walls and the base slab. That is called as the circular water tank with flexible joint. Number two, the movement of side wall is restricted by providing fixity or continuity with the base. That means the circular wall of the water tank is fixed to the base at the joint between wall and base slab. Now let us see the first type in this lecture, circular water tank resting on ground with flexible joint at the base. So here we are going to see in detail about the circular water tank which is resting on the ground and the base is flexible. That means here we can see whatever these we are seeing is nothing but the circular wall, and here it is a circular base slab here, and this portion, that is the joint between the circular wall and the base slab, it is not rigid, but the sliding joint is provided, and sliding joint acts as a flexible joint, and therefore whenever the water is filled inside and we want to draw the imaginary deflected shape of this, then the deflected shape will be something like this. That means since it is a sliding joint which is a type of flexible joint, and therefore there is no rigid connection between the wall and the base slab, and therefore it will try to deflect out in the manner which is shown in this figure. Now we know from fluid mechanics concepts that hydraulic pressure always increases with the depth. That means here when the water is filled in the tank, the pressure at the top is zero, and as we go towards bottom the pressure goes on increasing. Therefore at any random depth h, that means at any depth h from the top, the pressure is gamma w into h, where gamma w is the unit weight of water. We normally take it as 9.8 kN per meter cube. However, we know that at the base the maximum water pressure occurs, and it is given as gamma W into H. Here this capital H is nothing but the total depth of the water, and therefore the maximum pressure occurs at the base whose value is gamma W into H. This causes the circumferential tension or the hoop tension in the circular walls of the water tank. Now, as per the theory of thin cylinders, which we learn in strength of materials normally, the hoop or circumferential stress occurring in the circular walls of the water tank when subjected to an internal fluid pressure P is given as sigma C. C stands for circumferential or hoop. So sigma C is equal to PD by 2T, where P is the pressure of internal fluid, that is water in this case, D is the internal diameter of the water tank, and T is the thickness of the wall. So this equation is normally covered in strength of materials under thin cylindrical shell theory. But again, if we consider this diagram, and now I have shown a part of circular wall of a circular water tank whose thickness is T, and I have considered 1 meter height. So this shaded area I have considered, and because of the water pressure from inside, there is a axial tension in the wall, that is called as hoop tension or circumferential tension, because it acts along the circumference of the circular wall, that is nothing but T. And therefore here we can see that stress is force by area. So stress here is sigma C, that is circumferential stress or hoop stress. Force is tension T, whereas area over which that tension is acting is T, that is thickness into height, that is 1 meter. And therefore here equation 1 also talks about circumferential stress, and equation 2 also talks about circumferential stress. Therefore we can equate 1 and 2. So equating equations 1 and 2, we get tension is equal to PD by 2. So this is one of the important equations in circular water tanks which are flexible at the base. That is, tension is pressure into diameter by 2. But we know that the pressure is maximum at the base of the tank, and therefore maximum hoop tension will occur at the base, and that is nothing but in place of P we have to substitute gamma W into H, because few minutes back we have seen that the pressure at the bottom has a maximum value equal to gamma W into total height H of the water into internal diameter divided by 2. So this is a formula for the hoop tension T in Newton or kilonewtons. The section of wall should be designed for the hoop tension. There is no question of bending moment, because already we have discussed few minutes back that since the joint between the circular walls and the base slab is made flexible by providing sliding joint, and therefore the internal pressure or the stresses caused by internal pressure of fluid has to be resisted by developing hoop tension. We cannot resist it by developing bending moment, because there is no rigidity between the circular wall and the base slab, and therefore the section of the wall should be designed for hoop tension only. As the pressure decreases from base to top, the hoop tension T also decreases from base to top. That means at the base there will be maximum hoop tension, and as we go towards top, the tension will go on reducing. Therefore, for economy, the steel may be also reduced towards the top. The thickness of wall can also be reduced, but however, this is done for very large capacity water tanks. Hoop steel is the main steel, which is provided in the form of horizontal rings, which are called as hoop rings. Obviously, vertical steel is a distribution steel. To reduce the labor of fixing the steel, the horizontal steel, that is hoop rings, it is normally placed on the outer layers, and the vertical steel or distribution steel, it is placed inside the horizontal rings. Horizontal steel should be properly curved in a hooping machine, and it should not be bent in a series of kinks. It is obvious that it is not possible to use one bar for a complete perimeter of the wall of the water tank, because the reinforcement bars available will be in the limited length, and therefore whatever the bars available, we cannot use a single bar to cover the whole perimeter of the circular water tank, and therefore there is a necessity of lapping of bars. we know that for an ordinary slab or beam, that is RCC slab or beam, we lap the bars at the region where the stresses are reduced to approximately 50%. But however, in circular water tanks at all the sections of the hoop rings, that means the circular rings, the stress is the same. There is no reduction in the stress. And therefore, it is preferable to carefully plan the splicing of steel to see that splices are very well staggered. When lapped, that means when the bars are lapped, the lap length should be 2 times the development length. All the bars should not be lapped at one section and should be staggered. It is really very dangerous if we try to lap all the circular rings at one section. They should be staggered in manner. Not more than one bar in three should be lapped at any vertical section. At any vertical section, axial tension is shared by concrete as well as steel. However, at the section where there is a vertical joint provision, only steel resists the tension. Concrete doesn't resist the tension, and therefore steel is provided to carry all the tension at the vertical joint. The bars should not be lapped at or near the vertical joint. Base of the tank resting on the ground should be thick enough to make it non-porous. That means the base slab, which is of course circular in nature, which is directly resting on the ground, should be thick enough so that it should not be porous, it should be non-porous. This is from durability point of view. The minimum thickness of the base slab should be 200 mm. We should not provide the thickness of the base slab less than 200 mm. However, very importantly, the base slab shall be cast in a concrete and steel in a single layer. There is no necessary to design the steel for the base slab. We can provide the nominal steel in the base slab. The floor should rest on at least 75 mm thick screed of M15 grade concrete. The screed top will be covered with a separating layer of bitumen paper or polyethylene sheet of mass 1 kg per meter square. That means after the 75 mm thick screed of at least M15 grade concrete is laid, then there should be a bitumen layer or a polyethylene paper of mass 1 kg per meter square, which should be laid on that screed top before the base slab is poured on that. This destroys the bond between the screed and the floor concrete. Thank you very much.